how do I make myself stand out? That's a great question to ask. I think that a lot of people get into the computer industry who are not from the computer industry, right? They may have degrees in music or business administration or what have you, but now they're interested in doing computer things. They may not have had a job doing computer things before, but I think that running your own systems, starting up a project and, you know, working on it will not only help you gain experience in that. If you're interviewing with someone and you've not come from a technical background, you now have something that you can tell them about a technical topic that you have gained expertise in and learned and been successful at. This is one that I have a lot when we're doing things like interviewing with interns. Interns often are still in university. They may have very limited experience in the workforce. And so I ask them about things that they're doing as hobbies or in their coursework. And I ask them about what has been interesting and what's been challenging to kind of see where their interests lie, what they've dug in and learned about, or what they find industry interesting, to see if they're a good fit for the types of things that we do. Be prepared to talk about things that maybe are not your job, but are things that you have done with Linux. I have a Linux machine that I use every day. I really enjoy it. Well, the follow-up question is, why do you enjoy it, right? So be able to have those conversations, especially as you're moving into something like an administrative, system administrator type role. Again, if you don't have experience, if I've been system administering my own system, that's experience, even if it's not corporate experience. Things like development, software development, same thing. I'm writing my own application. I've enhanced it over time. These are the things I've learned about it when I've been doing it, right? Those are all technical interview content things that you can bring to the table, even though that's not maybe in your background or not something that you've been paid to work on. I think the recommendation that I often see online is like, oh, it's open source, get involved with the community. That one is harder to do. One, because you can't control a community, you can only control your interactions with that community. And then often when someone is new to a project, if it's an established project, people probably aren't interested in handing them really impactful, large scale work because they're brand new and they have no idea whether that person is capable of doing that work or not. But if you assign it to them and it doesn't get done, that can have consequences for the project, right? So if you're going to go the route of, I want to be involved in a community project, an open source project, start small. I'm going to read the email archives and kind of get familiarization. I'm going to show up places like their Discord or their subreddit, and I'm going to answer questions about the project. I'm going to help people with it by demonstrating expertise. I'm going to participate in testing and QA of the project, and I'll actually provide feedback and bugs. When they ask me for additional information, I'll be responsive and provide the information the developer working on my bug or my QE highlighted problem is asking me about it. So those are the things that you, those are the behaviors that you can start with when you're interacting with an open source project that will help you gain visibility in the project so that you can then start to transition into more critical roles within that project, right? More responsible roles within that project, because you've demonstrated your commitment, your expertise, and your availability. So people are willing to trust you with more stuff. But no one's going to, like, if you're new to a project, they're not going to make you a GitHub committer like first day, right? That's usually things that you need to earn. And it may be that you have to submit PRs, right? Pull requests or merge requests for applying changes, and there will be code reviews and other things. So I think that's the one, when I like look at Reddit, that's the one people are always saying like, oh, just get in a project. And it's like, that's a lot harder than you think it is, but it can be done and it can be very rewarding. You just have to put in the effort starting at the beginning to kind of gain notoriety and trust within the community. All right. Yeah, I see Hank has some thoughts around open source developers and project developers. And yeah. And Josh said beta testing. Yep. right? Providing feedback, putting in effort, showing that you're putting in effort, I think goes a long way with open source communities. Joshua Ox suggested Ansible. And I see some statements on things like Terraform and DevOps. So those are collections of skills, right? So Azure, if you're interested in Ansible, right? Ansible is an automation technology. The first question is, what are you automating, right? Like, you don't just do Ansible. You use Ansible to accomplish a task and you write automation to perform a thing, right? So you have to think about, what is the thing I'm going to solve with this technology? What is the project I'm going to take on with this technology? But yeah, those are great additional skills that are Linux related that are very in demand in the job marketplace, right? Because being able to automate and being able to be more effective because you can operate at a higher scale is really handy. You know, when I started in system administration back in the olden days, administrators were responsible for administering like 5 or 10 systems because every single one was lovingly maintained over time. You edited the files, you individually added users to different boxes, you managed the storage individually. That's not how we operate now. In cloud world, you spin up boxes whenever, shut them down whenever. And you need to have practices and procedures for supporting that type of workload. Now, system administrators administer hundreds or thousands of systems at a time. Well, if you're operating at that scale, you need to apply changes at the hundreds or thousands of systems scale. And you need to have the same amount of administrator work effort. And then the outcome is that work effort gets pushed across all these larger groups of machines. And that's where stuff like Ansible comes in real handy.